opportunity to reform and to be a law-abiding citizen. And we are asking that this particular principle should be the driving force behind any sentence that this court may impose. UNAR's emphasis in the year 2013, 19 prisons closed down in the Netherlands. And the reason why they closed down was because the country did not have enough criminals. In fact, a year before that, the country imported 240 prisoners from Norway to keep them.
Sorry, you want to be late, yes. My land of friend gave us the source of this information. So that's the elsewhere to respond.
I want to respond to a question that was within the public domain. If you go to BBC, it covered this story.
No, no. What is the source of your information? I think that is a legitimate expectation.
Oh, okay, Yona, I had felt that this information is in the public domain. But if Mr. Muteti wants me to, and I don't think he needs to respond to it because I'm trying to just persuade the court about the philosophy behind rehabilitation.
This is a public domain. And Your Honor, we strongly object, we should be stopped in that line of submission.
Yes, Mr. Okubasu, unfortunately, we cannot work on something that has no legal basis. If it has a legal foundation, then we can proceed to have it quoted.
It is not a legal authority I'm referring to. That's why I misapply a copy, Mr. Muteti. But anyone who pays keen attention to the fourth estate has come across this information. I'm not suggesting that Mr. Muteti does not pay attention to the fourth estate, but I can drop that line of submission.
That would be good, Mr. Kubasu. Thank you.
Yes, Your Honor, so one of the considerations in sum that should guide you is the need to rehabilitate, which normally acts against a custodial sentence. The second principle that should guide the court is what is set out in statute. And we're referring to section 26(2) of the Penal Code, which provides that the court might impose a shorter sentence. And that has indeed been the practice. Until recently, Your Honor, it had been known that certain types of offences, such as murder, attract a mandatory sentence set out in statute. But the Supreme Court has advised us otherwise. And I wouldn't go into that, except just to emphasize that statute gives courts discretion to determine a shorter sentence than one that has been set out. The third consideration, Your Honor, is that the age of an accused person is a very important consideration that cannot be ignored. Referring my colleague, Mr. Muteti, in particular, to a judgment of Wilson Kipkorir Kosgei versus Republic, and I'll be supplying the court with a copy. And this judgment dealt with the question that is very similar to what we are dealing with here today. It was a judgment of Justice Mativo. And Your Honor, under paragraphs 34, Mativo here, in my view, assured his immortality in justice jurisprudence when he said, under paragraph 34, that a time has come, and I'm quoting him verbatim, that a time has come for our criminal justice system to review sentencing and to determine which can be adjusted to reduce the elderly prisoners' population without risking public safety. He was talking about elderly persons. In that case, the appellant was 80 years old during the trial, and at the time of writing the judgment, Justice Mativo speculated that he was about 85. And the judge said in the judgment, that correctional facilities should review the conditions of confinement for elderly prisoners and advised for what he called services and programs that enabled them to make changes and to ensure that human rights are met. But the most important point, he said, in this case that was dealing with sexual offenses, that the maximum penalty was not necessary in the circumstances because of the age of the accused person. And Your Honor, I'll therefore be asking you to consider the pronouncements of Mativo, Justice Mativo, as one of the considerations when you are deciding on the proper sentence to impose, particularly on the first accused. And in fact, Your Honor, more particularly...
The citation again, please.
It is the case of Wilson Kipchirchir Kosgei versus the Republic.
Criminal appeal number?
It's criminal appeal number 333 of 2013 at Nakuru, the High Court proceeding at Nakuru. And Your Honor, I want to read just a sentence of that judgment as I move to my next consideration. Justice Mativo said that keeping a person aged 85 in prison under harsh conditions, when he is not a danger even to himself, is something that should prick the conscience of humanity. And our entire criminal justice system. And Mativo said this under paragraph 35, that this amounts to sentencing a person to slow death. That's what his words are. At paragraph 39, Justice Mativo cites Chief Justice John Marshall and says that courts are not mere instruments of law and can do nothing. That's what he says. And one of this judgment has a very compelling force. The last consideration, Your Honor, that I would like you to take into account is the character of the accused person. That is a consideration. So, Your Honor, guided by these considerations, our humble view is that in respect of the offences set out in the Penal Code, the first accused does not deserve a custodial sentence. She deserves something different. Your Honor, the first accused is 79 years of age. She's probably older than all of us gathered here today. And all she would deserve from us is fairness when you are to judge her. Ms. Gatelu told us last week that in spite of her age, 79 years, she is a first offender. That means that for all her life, this is her first encounter and interaction with the criminal justice system. I'm sure most of us would be lucky to have such a testimonial at 79. She has spent all her life until retirement, Your Honor, in public service. Rising to be the first woman to head a parastatal at some point. This is not an effort to discard when sentencing her. Your Honor, we have perused legal authorities dealing with the two sets of offences, that is uttering and perjuring, and related offences like fraud, and we are convinced on this occasion beyond the reasonable doubt that the court should impose a fine for those two offences for 100,000 shillings for each of them. Our conviction is based on a decision of the Court of Appeal in the case of Joseph Mureithi Kanyita versus Republic. Which is Criminal Appeal number 35 of 2017. This litigation that started in the Chief Magistrate's Court and ended up at the Court of Appeal, the trial court had imposed a fine of 100,000 shillings or in the alternative 6 months of imprisonment. A and the Director of Public Prosecutions was unhappy with that decision. He filed an appeal to the High Court before Justice Masharia Genye, and the High Court found that the effect that the punishment was not commensurate with the offense. In particular, there was an amount of money, a property valued at 65 million, if I'm not wrong, which the complainant was likely to lose, unless I am misreading the judgment, but I'll give a copy to the court, and therefore enhanced the sentence. When the matter reached the Court of Appeal, the Court of Appeal took issues with the enhancement and reinstated the fine of 100,000, basically the trial court's penalty. And that is now the law as we speak. Nothing has changed. And we're asking this court to be guided by the wisdom in this judgment of the Court of Appeal and sentence the first accused to a fine of 100,000 for counts number 1 and number 2. We could have asked Your Honor for a smaller amount, but we have no precedent, so we will be guided by what the Court of Appeal has said. The last set of counts are under a seca. That's count number 3 and count number 4. And Your Honor, under counts number 3 and number 4, statute gives you discretion again. Tells you that you can impose a fine of not more than 1 million shillings or an imprisonment. In a case where a fine has been set out in statute by Parliament, Your Honor, we are arguing that based on the considerations you've argued, the path to take that is fair, that is just and lawful, is one that leans towards a lenient fine. Lastly, Your Honor, Section 48 also enjoins the court to impose a mandatory fine. This mandatory fine, Your Honor, is computed on the basis of the benefit that somebody received as a result of the complaint conduct. In its judgment and during hearing, this court alluded, reference was made to a figure that is known, a figure of 40 million shillings. And we are asking that when the court is computing the mandatory fine, it's not a mandatory sentence, a mandatory fine is a distinction there with a difference, that the court should consider only 40 million shillings on account of the first accused. Your Honor, lastly, we are also asking the court to consider that it's only part of the decretal amount that had been challenged through the criminal court. In fact, Your Honor, there was an excess of 2.7 million even in respect of the amount disclosed in the charge. The accused person has informed me, and indeed I'm aware, that she is quite remorseful. Your Honor, she informs me that she is also deeply regretful. She regrets that she tendered for the supply of 40,000 metric tons of maize. Had she not done that, we would not be here today. And she's asking that you exercise your discretion in her favor. Grant her a non-custodial sentence, fine. In consideration also that she is ailing. Has been for some time now on high blood pressure treatment. We have presented one or two documents in the course of trial and asking for an adjournment or explaining her absence in court on an occasion. And we ask that this court does not spell punishment that will be deleterious to our health. Thank you.